June 18th. This is our recess meeting. We will first call the meeting to order, stand for the Pledge of Allegiance, followed by an invocation from Alderman Sistrunk and a moment of silence.
If you will please join me.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Alderman Sistrunk, if you would please.
Eternal God, fount of wisdom, we ask you to bless us as elected representatives. Grant that through our discussions and decisions, we may solve our problems effectively, enhance the well-being of our community, and achieve together a fairer and more united society. Amen.
All right, thank you, everyone. We appreciate you joining us for our meeting. Our first order of business will be to approve the official agenda with consented items, and we have added, I sent an email out earlier, we have added two items to the agenda, and we've gotten a number on another one, and I believe they're consent worthy, but I'll leave that to someone to make that motion. So, Alderman Moreland, any changes or additions to the agenda?
No, ma'am, but that's...
Okay. Alderman Rupp?
Yes, ma'am. I would like the board to consider adding... under Board Business A, the engagement with Walkinville and Stafford,
okay.
The Engineering One, as well as the low quote for the ground wire fiber leak project.
Okay. Any objections to adding those items to the consent agenda? Any objections? Seeing none, we'll add those to the consent agenda. Any other changes? Alderman Rupp?
No, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. Alderman Brooks?
No, ma'am. Thank you.
All right. Alderman Beatty?
Mayor, I said that under the utilities department, had that bridge, a bunch of bridges, and
that's
request authorization to accept low quote on that.
That's for the optical ground wire. The bridge is under engineering. Is that the one you had in mind?
I'm sorry.
That's okay. That was Alderman Rupp added that one to the...
Okay. No, I had one. The bridge, where is it?
It's under engineering.
Okay.
Yes. Okay. Thank you. Alderman Sistrunk?
No, ma'am. Thank you.
Vice Mayor?
No, ma'am. Thank you.
Alderman Vaughn?
No, ma'am. Mayor, thank you.
All right. If there are no changes, any further changes, I'll take a motion to approve the agenda with the consented items as amended.
So moved.
I have a motion from Alderman Rupp. Do I have a second?
Second.
Second from Alderman Moreland. If you would please answer yea or nay as the city clerk calls your name. And we are doing a roll call, ladies and gentlemen, on this because we do have someone. One of our aldermen is calling in on the phone, and so that necessitates a roll call. So, Ms. Harden.
Alderman Moreland.
Yay.
Alderman Rupp.
Yay.
Alderman Brooks.
Yay.
Alderman Beatty.
Yay.
Alderman Sistrunk.
Yay.
Vice Mayor Perkins.
Yay.
Alderman Vaughn.
Yay.
All right, it is unanimous. Thank you so much. And with that, I will read the consented items. First, we have consideration of the minutes of the May 31st, 2024 work session of the Mayor and Board of Aldermen of the City of Starkville. We have consideration of the minutes of the June 4th, 2024 regular meeting of the Mayor and Board of Aldermen of the City of Starkville. We have under Board Business approval of the engagement of Watkins, Wards, and Stafford, PLLC, for the fiscal year 2023 audit for the City of Starkville. We have under engineering consideration of accepting the low quote from Helms Polyfoam LLC in the amount of $11,050 to provide bank stabilization for a bridge located on Reed Road. Under finance administration, we have acceptance of the May 2024 financial statements. Under number three is request authorization to transfer police 2007 Crown Vic vehicle number 2FAFP71W17X 132882 to the Airport Department. Under the Fire Department, we have request permission for LaShonda R. Malone to attend the Emergency Services Administrative Professional Association Conference on September the 3rd through the 6th, 2024 in Natchez, Mississippi, with advanced travel not to exceed $850. Under HR, we have request authorization to hire Nellie Vargas, Angelo McGlory, Asher Wade, and Samuel Zam as police officers. And any of those names that I butchered, I apologize in advance. Two is request authorization to hire Quinn Holland and Jordan Slusher as non-certified firefighters in the Starkville Fire Department. Three is request authorization to hire Blaine Tiniak as a temporary full-time firefighter in the Starkville Fire Department. Four is request authorization to hire John Ricks as a wastewater operator, too. Under Information Technology, we have number one, request approval of purchase of a firewall from Next Step for $11,675, the lowest quote. Under Parks, we have consideration of approving a professional services contract with Neil Schaefer, Inc. for stormwater pollution prevention plan permitting for the McKee Park Improvements Project in the amount of $2,000. Under Code Enforcement, we have consideration of calling for a public hearing under Mississippi Code Annotated 21-1911 to determine whether the structure is located at 12850 Mississippi Highway 182, Starkville, Mississippi 39759, with a parcel number 159J-00-025.00 is a menace to the public health, safety, and welfare of the community. We have item B, which is consideration of calling for a public hearing under Mississippi Code Annotated 21-1911 to determine whether the structure is located at 200 Pilcher Street, Starkville, Mississippi 39759, with the parcel number 118000-002.00 is a menace to the public health, safety, and welfare of the community. Utilities Department, we have consideration of accepting the low bid of $216,000 for the electrical vehicle charging station installation, rebid from JMM Farm and Company, LLC, and authorizing the mayor to execute a construction contract. Two is request authorization to advertise for bids for the aeration and electrical improvements project at the wastewater treatment plant. Three is request authorization to advertise for request for qualifications, RFQ, from qualified engineering firms to provide consultant services for projects related to water and wastewater infrastructure. Four is request authorization to accept the low quote from Burns Dirt in the amount of $9,000 for labor in repairing a retaining wall that was removed due to a sewer rehabilitation project. And number five is request authorization to accept the low quote from Gresco in the amount of $6,600 for optical ground wire for the fiber loop project. And that concludes those consent agenda items.
Thank you, Mayor.
Happy to do that. Under announcements and comments, under Mayor's comments, I'm just going to make a couple, and I wanted to, he's going to come up here in a few minutes, I feel sure, under citizens' comments, but I wanted to acknowledge Mr. Turner's award at the NAACP banquet on Sunday night. So I think his longtime service to the community was finally acknowledged, and he got an award, so I'm very proud for him and of him. So wanted to say that, and wanted to also mention that we had a huge Dizzy Dean tournament this weekend. We had 45 to 50 teams or so, and I heard this morning from some of the Chamber of Commerce GSDP board members that they are feeling every bit of the activity out at the Cornerstone Park with their restaurants, and the hotels are all feeling the impact of that. So that is that's certainly good news, and that was a large part of what we intended to do, so much so that they're having trouble finding people to fill those service positions. So if anybody knows anybody wants a job, I believe there's some positions out there somewhere that could be filled. So, and that will conclude my comments, with the exception of acknowledging former Supervisor Miller is in the audience. She's going to make a presentation to us. So we appreciate her presence and look forward to that. So no further comments from me. Alderman Moreland.
No, ma'am.
Alderman Rupp.
No, ma'am.
Alderman Brooks.
No, Mayor. Thank you.
Alderman Beatty.
No, Mayor. Thank you.
Alderman Sistrunk.
No, Mayor. Thank you.
Vice Mayor Perkins.
Thank you, Mayor. Mayor, I had asked you briefly to allow me to have the floor for just a few minutes for a very important matter, and this is a very important public matter. And Mayor, as I looked at my agenda a few days ago, I saw an item on there that referenced the Mississippi Horse Park. And that item, as I read it then, Mayor, seemed to allow me to read some language that Ms. Honorable Brickley Miller is resigning or retiring as the director of the Mississippi Horse Park. So, Ms. Miller, with that being said, I must take this opportunity to say that I want to recognize your very distinguished service. In your letter to the mayor, you reference and clearly indicate at the beginning of that letter that the Horse Park is 25 years old. It began in 1999. That was my second term as a member of the Starkville Board of Aldermen under the mayorship of the late and the deceased Honorable Mac Rutledge. You have served with distinction. You have served with the highest level of professionalism. At all times when you came to our board, all of us look forward to hearing from you and seeing you. That is because you always came to us with a very high level of excitement, a very high level of enthusiasm, and you always exemplified at all times a high level of passion. And as we look back to 1999, 25 years ago, the Horse Park has grown enormously, and that is because of your exemplary leadership. And I remember during the Alderman McLaurin days as an alderman, he served two terms with us from 2001 to 2009. He and I often chatted about it, but about how you were just so convincing, and how you just always were so successful in getting what you asked for the Horse Park. And given the fact that we did that, Honorable Ms. Brickley Miller, our city has benefited from your leadership, your service, your commitment, and your dedication enormously. As you mentioned, the Horse Park has become a landmark, and you had the can-do attitude at all times. You were unwavering, and your unwaveringness was very consistent. You were very faithful, and you never gave up. And the facility is a thriving facility because of your leadership. Upon your retirement, you have exemplified traits, attributes, and characteristics that are irreplaceable. And these comments are easy to make, Honorable Supervisor, because they're genuine. I was there and personally observed them. These are my personal observations. And at one point in time, I was on the budget committee. We had the alderman at large during that term. Dr. Vic Zitter was the alderman at large. And some good days, that was before we got to the consent. Everyone had to come down and make their case, and you never failed to do so. So, and I always want to say that to you. I've been wanting to say that to you. And also, you did, in my opinion, a very good job. I want you to know this. You did a very good job in representing, in my opinion, Octavia Hall County. You know, you showed good leadership as a member of the board. You gave good direction. You gave good conservative guidance and leadership. And not only did your supervisor district benefit, but this city, this county, and this state. And you also exemplified your desire to move forward to the state of Mississippi. And if you had made it there, you would have been one of the best senators in our state. And so I just want to share these things with you. And sometimes we have to take the time to say these things to people. You're just one of a few. And hopefully the Horse Park can keep going, but it is going to be dearly missed. So, Honorable Supervisor, it has been a pleasure. It's been a joy. It's been an excitement to just be in your presence, just to know you were coming to our meeting, just to hear from you. I mean, it takes all of you just to understand. If you had been there, you would know exactly what I'm talking about. But, Mayor, I just wanted to take the time, because the Honorable Supervisor is very deserving of every word that I said. And I'm going to pray that God will continue to bless her, to be with her, and to keep her in his care at all times. And I'm finally praying that she will be successful, and I know she will, in all of her endeavors. Mayor, you're the floor, and thank you.
Thank you, Vice Mayor. That was very well said, I'm sure, echoed by all of the members of the board. So thank you. Alderman Vaughn.
No, ma'am, ma'am. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. All right. Next, we have citizens' comments. Anyone who wishes to may come provide the board with 3 minutes of input on on things, compliments, complaints, concerns, any of those things are welcome.
On behalf of the NACP, we want to thank our city for making us stand tall and being the voice of them that cannot speak for themselves. Gladly, we thank you very much. I want to thank Assistant Chief Stewart for having the steward me in the right direction. I lost my feet. But made sure I got back to my seat. And thank him for that. In the coming days, we have our slogan was let all hands in, all hands on deck. We're looking at a very serious election, and we have a person that has 34 counts and is convicted felon, and he would love to give revenge to everyone that had anything to do with that. But I know we would want to try and be prepared. We hope and pray that we can get the NEMO Center back up and running so that no one will have no excuse for not voting. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Turner. Anyone else? Anyone else? Seeing none, I will close citizens' comments. We have a public appearance from Ms. Miller. If you'd like to join us now, I don't know who all you've got coming with you. I'm going to cut the overhead light so we can see your...
Mayor Perkins, thank you so much.
You're welcome.
I appreciate your kind words.
Yes, ma'am.
So, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chief.
So, again, Mayor and Board of Aldermen, I want to say thank you for allowing me to come in front of you. This will be my 24th year to stand in front of you, and what an honor it has been to represent you over the years in this position. I definitely could not have done it without partnership. We were obligated at the beginning, if you remember. The city was for 3 years, and the county was for 4. And we were actually built during the time of Jim Buck Ross. And Jim Buck Ross was the former commissioner of agriculture, and he believed that every county should have a horse arena. And he said what was good for the outside of a horse, or the outside of a horse, was good for the inside of a man. That was his firm belief. We were built during that same time. That was a matching grant. We were built during that same time, but we were actually built on 2 state lines. So such a blessing that was to come to our community, 2 separate state lines. And it was developed as a partnership, and as you all know, it was the first actual 3-part partnership in our community. There had been 2-part partnerships, but it was the very first 3-part one between the city, county, and the university. So I wanted to share with you a little trip down memory lane and how we got started, and let's walk through how we got to the success level that we are, because we are truly a fairy tale story that very few people across the country can tell. A very successful partnership. So you'll see right here, this is the groundbreaking ceremony. And you can see Honorable Hamilton is on the shovel, Holland. You've also got David Wade, who is the Director of Farm Bureau, Dr. Foyle, Dr. Zacharias, and a few other people. When we were actually built, we were just 3-4 metal buildings on a gravel road. So how did we get to where we are? If you look at the picture on the right, I'm going to talk a little bit about the development and what we did. In 2001, I got a call from Dr. Brown, and he said Brickley, Speaker Ford at the time wanted to move a therapeutic riding program to Mississippi State, to the horse park. So that's how we got the first half of the covered arena, is we got that therapeutic riding program, which you know was very successful in our facility, and actually got a grant to build another facility in another area. The first little section of our RVs, right there in the very front, it's a small section. Sometimes it's better to beg for forgiveness than ask for permission. Well, I got a call from the president's office in 2003, and they said, Brickley, how did you get a line item in the state budget for $50,000 for RV pedestals? And I said, I don't know, but I really actually did know. At the time, the head of appropriations, Jack Gordon, I had talked to him a little bit, and he said, I told him, I said, we need RV pedestals. We have to have those to move it forward. And he was nice enough to put that in the budget for us. The other part came when you can see the other part of the RVs, because we've got 133 out there. I got another call from the president's office, and they said, if we had $800,000, what would you do with it? And I said, well, we would work on the harness track, because that's one of the only areas that hadn't been super successful, and we'd move the dirt and build additional RVs. And so that's exactly what we did. And not only did that open us up to reopening the harness track and having harness training where you can see all the way around the track and use it for additional areas and different additional things, it also opened us up for our RV parking for our football games. So you know, we now also host RV parking for our football games. The other part of the covered arena was also an addition by Mississippi State University. But other than the things, the big items like that, every year or every 2 years, we take on a really big project, the horse park staff, to make ourselves look better. So the pretty pipe fence in the front was something that in-house we did, the staff. The seats on the inside of the building, that was something we did in-house as well. And then if you look, there's also room for additional development. As you know, we sell out a lot. I mean, 4 or 5 times a year. We don't have enough stalls. People want to come to this facility, and it is still growing. I'm going to show you that. It's thriving. We're still getting new events, multi-day events, every single year. The place right there on the other side is actually a future barn pad. It's been there for quite some time. We're on the list of the building or bureaus for additional stalls. But we take temporary stalls and put them in that covered arena. We add about 70 or 80 more and still sell out and have to overflow to the local facilities in the area, the local barns and stuff. So there's ample room for growth. There's ample events. There's more people that want to come. We offer so many unique things because we're secure horse facility or family-friendly event, whatever you're doing out there, and we have great amenities that are close. There are so many things that make us appealing to people that want to come here. One of the other things that we did in the very beginning is because we were a three-part partnership, it started off being called the MSU Agri Center. So actually, Deborah Schaefer from Ducks Deluxe, if you remember a long time ago, she gathered a group of students together, and I said, we've got to come up with a different name. We need to brand this. We need to logo this. We need to make sure it's something that people know, and it is inclusive to all of us because it was a three-part partnership. And so we came up with this, and so that logo is known all over the country now, the Mississippi Horse Park. She was so nice to do that. The front entrance right there, when we built that, that was Doss Broadnecks. That's actually an original John Deere wooden wagon in there that he helped find us, and we built the front entrance. So we've come a long way aesthetically and physically. I will say, too, under my leadership, we have had 1,440,000 people come to the events, and they have generated, those events have generated a $63 million economic impact for our area. So other than the horse park and the events and selling out the events and the 2% tourism tax and the things like that that we focus on and we have really, really done well at, we also have driven economic development. When I started, we didn't have a paved road. It was a gravel road. We were, kind of on the back side of a campus, out of sight, out of mind. That was a lot of challenges just from the beginning. But in 2001, Don Posey called and he said, Brickley, we're trying to get a grant from the county to pay Poorhouse Road. And he said, we're going to have Mabel Murphy come in from the ARC office. Will you give her a presentation? And I did. And she looked at me after the presentation and she said, you need a gravel road, don't you? And so the county actually got a grant to pave the road. So from there, there was only one house in Sunnyland. But guess what happened after the road became paved? Sunnyland developed. That's just a prime example of how things like this happen. But not just Sunnyland. I mean, after Sunnyland, then we needed natural gas. The horse park helped stimulate natural gas for not just us, but for all of the local citizens that were in the area. The same thing with the fiber. It's just a way to show that a facility in an area can be an economic developer too, not just a driver, and that's what the horse park has done. And then, of course, Hell State Boulevard, you know, which runs down the other side of the horse park all the way to campus, which was a partnership as well. The horse park played a major role in that. So very proud of those accomplishments too. So if you look, when I started, we started the Walk of Fame. If you've ever been out to the horse park and seen the wall, every newspaper article, every magazine that we've ever been in is placed out there. The first time we ever sold out on a spectator type event was 2006, and that was the motocross right there. Todd was a promoter from Oklahoma City, so important to have quality promoters. To the level of the facility that we have. There are 82 publicly funded arenas in this state. If you're not a certain level promoter, then you probably need to start somewhere else and make sure you can fill those stands before you come to us. And that's just part of what we've done to make our level of entertainment higher, is we have a certain standard that we require. But in 2006, Todd sold out. He had that indoor motocross, if you remember. They did the crazy back flips and things like that. And people had never seen that in the area. They were sitting in the steps. I was just grateful that the fire marshal was sitting in there with me that night. But we actually had to turn people away, and that was just a fantastic thing. That promoter actually outgrew us. He does huge facilities now, like Oklahoma City, where they hold hundreds of thousands of people. But guess what? During COVID, all those other states weren't open. So he came back to Starkville, and I worked with Mississippi State, and we had that event. And he had the people there, and y'all, we were on Fox Sports News because that's how big he had gotten, but he came back to the state. So that's just how some of those things work. The CVB banquet, y'all remember going out there and it being freezing on the floor, and we had on our heels, and we had the banquet. So before we had the meal, we had all of those types of things out there as well. Eric Church, when he had him in concert, 10 years to the day that he was out there, he won Entertainer of the Year. Shows the quality of the events that we've had in here. If you look over here on the last slide, do y'all remember when the hurricane victims were here from Florida? And we kept those horses for so long, and the community all chipped in and paid for the supplements to feed the horses. I mean, it's just such positive PR that's all over the state and all over the country. So let's talk about some of the accolades that we got. Pro Sports News, national publication for rodeos. That's us in that article right there. That's the Houston Livestock Rodeo above it. We're on the same page with Houston Livestock Rodeo guys. They have 1.3 million people that come to their rodeo, and our picture's bigger. There we are with the check highlighted on that page right there. I mean, that's amazing. The next slide is the AQHA show in 2011. We had the oldest AQHA show in the state of Mississippi in the horse park, and they asked us to come in and revamp the horse park staff, actually, to retake over the management of that show, and so we did. We had a 267% increase in attendance the first year just by changing the dynamics of what we were doing, and another 90%. Again, just huge accolades all over for that. That on the right top up there, that's the Barrel Horse News. That's the largest barrel racing publication in the country. I mean, it's all over. It's not national. It goes overseas as well, too. And so we opened that up. We had Northley Idea. That's fabulous, fabulous facilities is what it says. And there we are. That's the big picture. We're the big picture on the top. It's an aerial shot. We had no earthly idea. We're on the same page with Oklahoma City that has 267 employees. We have four. We have 100 acres. We do everything in-house. But that's, I'm just telling y'all that because that's what people in the horse industry think of us. It's amazing. They're not better because they're bigger. It's the quality of what we offer here in this community. Right here on the bottom, that's we were honored to win BBR, National Producer of the Year. That's the SEC of barrel racing right there. That's the event that we produce and house. Every state has thousands of BBR barrel races every year, and we were selected. The Tourism Award, the Crystal Pineapple Tourism Award, Zacharias Award, numerous times have we stood on the stage in Las Vegas, Nevada, at the Wrangler Nationals Finals Rodeo. There are 9 states in the Southeastern Circuit. There are lots of pro rodeos. Probably the one that you know the best is the Dixie National. But guess who wins first place for the ground by the contestants voted on by everybody that goes to those events in the 9 states? Our rodeo, right there. So there again, just something to be super proud of. So what have we been doing in 2023 and 2024? I want to talk a little bit about the events that we've had. Again, just tremendous growth in the events. And there's several types of events that we have. You know, we have horse events, and then we have the non-horse events. So if you look right here, we actually, Wildlife and Fisheries had their district tournament here this year, brought about 3,000 children in. They bust them in every day. So we had the archery tournament. If you look at the slide on the left, that's the Lucky Dog Barrel Race that we have. And those are all the states that the contestants come from, right there, that's highlighted. Paid out over $100,000. That's the reason people drive from multiple states and drive past these other facilities and come to see us. Team Pennant on the right, that was a brand new event that we had this year, a multi-day event. There again, fantastic people that came in that have never been here before. The 4-H and educational type events that we've got right here, you also got Farmtastic. And then that event in the middle right there, that's a barrel race that moved here from Georgia, sold out the facility the very first time that it came. So there again, growing, thriving, not slowing down, new events, people wanting to come, just an absolutely amazing place. And thank you so much for being a partner in that. So this right here, this last slide, this is Christy Brown and Christy Lewis. And when she, I reached out to her, they're from Arkansas. And after Mary Jane, who had produced 26 NBHA Super Shows over 11 years and paid out over $11 million, I needed somebody to come. And so I actually, this is where the CVB grant came in and was so important because it was a cold call. And so I said, hey, if you'll come, that's what that grant's for, is to help start events, multi-day events. And if you'll come, we'll do this. Well, the first year, not many people knew about them. That was 2011, and they only had 187 runs because Arkansas had the largest floods they'd ever had, and that's where their crew was from, you know, their group of followers. But I talked to them, and I begged them to come back the next year. And they came back, and now they sell out the facility every single year, and we have to put up temporary stalls. And if you get a chance to read that, she goes all over the country, and she just talks about our facility and the staff. And I'm going to introduce them at the end to y'all, too, before we leave. So in saying all that, I just wanted to do a quick slideshow for y'all. And let's just take a walk down memory lane. And actually, even the tambourine that we did many years ago, I think there's a slide in there of that. Mayor Camp, y'all see him? Thank you. again, I just want to thank you for the opportunity. But I want to introduce the staff from the horse park, if I can. They all came tonight. And I want to tell you that I leave you in fantastic hands. Dana has been with me 16 years. She not only is an expert in what she does as far as the marketing end of it, I will tell you that we have to stay in compliance with a lot of rules and regulations, and they can never even find us anything wrong on our audits, which is really good. We just had a MSU internal audit, which is a really major ordeal, and there were three little minor things, one being a new key log, one being security cameras, one being something else that, so I say that in telling you that even on the front of the scenes, we're doing great, but behind the scenes, we are as well. And Dana does a great job, and she'll be staying with you. I've got Bailey Breeland. Bailey is newest. She's been with us a little over a year. She was actually the first female that I hired to be outside. She came from the poultry department. Travis Childress. Travis moved here years ago from Tennessee. I begged him to come. He's what you call a professional tractor driver, and he actually goes all over the country to other facilities when he's not working with us and does that. There is an art to that. And Travis is an expert in that. Casey is an unbelievable, is an unbelievable equipment operator and just does a fantastic job. So they keep the grounds looking great. Anytime you drive by, it's immaculate. And that's thanks to these three right here. And again, I just wanted to thank you for the opportunity. Very grateful.
Appreciate it. Now, how much money are you asking for this year?
Oh, yes.
See?
Well, it's for $50,000.
Okay. Yes. All right. Well, we're working on budgets. So
well, I appreciate that. Thank you for always doing it. This is strong.
Thank you so much.
Thank
you. All right. That was wonderful, and we greatly appreciate the walk down memory lane. It was fun to see. I don't remember Mayor Kent getting on an elephant. I miss that. I wanted to do that. That would be fun. All right, our next item is the first public hearing for amending the Municipal Code and Unified Development Code. Mr. Haviland. Yes, sir.
Mine won't be as entertaining.
That's quite all right.
So there's two parts to this, the Municipal Code and UDC. In the Municipal Code, all we're doing is repealing the fire suppression system section. That is now covered in the UDC from the previous approved UDC update. Then we are also amending the development standards for signs to allow for certain building sign types to be placed in institutional educational zone districts. That was just kind of an oversight initially. And then the big part of this is the right-of-way protection section. We already had one, but we're kind of repealing it and rolled it into this thing. So there's a purpose section that's been added, a damage to public infrastructure section, which is basically the old section, and then a permit process, and then the requirements for each type of work that might occur within the right-of-way. And then along with that, in Section 18, we're adding some definitions. So here's just a look at, like, the permit requirements. It's all the type of work that would be in the right-of-way that would require a permit. And then below it is the requirements, and that's just the categories. There's a paragraph for each one of those sections, kind of getting into more depth of what's expected of that type of work within the right-of-way. One of the big ones that kind of started this whole thing is the tree trimming and removal of any vegetation within the right-of-way. We kind of tightened this up to where now it's going to require that an ISA certified utility specialist is the only person who's permitted to do the work within the right-of-way, and then they have to apply the ANSI A300 standards, which are directly related to trimming trees within utility lines. And so that's, you know, those two, that section above it, and then the definitions that are being. And the reason we're doing the ISA certification is the state of Mississippi doesn't have any kind of certification or licensing of arborists. This is a nationally recognized kind of certification institute. So anybody who's a professional in that field has that certification.
Okay.
Is there any questions
for Mr. Haviland? All right.
Mayor, on his last you talked about, there was some talk,
because we've had some issues with tree trimmers in the last few months and stuff. I mean, wouldn't we need to require a permit if some of these people are third party or
previously, there is nothing written for people doing work in the right of way to have to obtain a permit. This is what this will take care of. It'll close that loophole. So it's not only saying you have to have a permit, but here's a requirement for the qualification.
You require them to obtain a permit from the city to be able to do the work, so we'll know before they get out there.
Yep.
And we have some type, I'm sure the planning department will have some kind of conference with them about what expectations
are. Yeah, and
for.
That's all in here, too. We need to know what the work zone is, what the traffic control is going to be like, what exactly you're
scope
doing,
the work.
Doing it, when you're doing it, how long you're going to be doing it. All that stuff's going to be defined during the permit.
Well, I know we've had some pre-terms that's gotten loose in some of your neighborhoods and stuff, and it's time we get on what they're doing. They
raise the expectations.
So do you think that'll kind of curve or kind of make it hopefully help to alleviate that in the future?
Anyone else? All right, I'm going to open it as a public hearing. This will be our first public hearing. We will have one more after this one at the next board meeting with an opportunity to pass it at that point in time. But now I'll open it as a public hearing. Anyone wishing to speak either for or against this particular item, now would be the time, either for or against. Seeing none, I will close it as a public hearing, and absent any more questions, we will take it up at the next board meeting. Thank you, Mr. Haviland. All right. And that takes us to, I believe we're down to the claims docket. Do I have a motion? I have a motion from Alderman Sistrunk. Do I have a second?
Second.
Second from Alderman Beatty. If you would please answer yea or nay as the city clerk calls your name.
Alderman Moreland.
Yea.
Alderman Rupp.
Yea.
Alderman Brooks.
Yea.
Alderman Beatty.
Yea.
Alderman Sistrunk.
Yea.
Vice Mayor Perkins.
Nay.
Alderman Vaughn.
All right, and that passes. We are at a point now where I can read the calling for the work session at the next meeting. In accordance with the notices required under Mississippi Code Annotated 254113, the board will have a work session on Friday, the 28th of June, 2024 at 11 a.m. That meeting will be held at City Hall in the second floor conference room located at 110 West Main. Notice shall be provided with this work session within 1 hour of this meeting. By posting such notice at City Hall, the notice should be made a part of the minutes of the board meeting. The work session will be an open public meeting of the city of Starkville, and the public and press are invited to attend. With that, I need a motion for us to adjourn. Alderman Baum? I have a second from Alderman Rupp. If you would, please, answer yea or nay as the city clerk calls your name.
Alderman Moreland.
Yea.
Alderman Rupp.
Yea.
Alderman Brooks.
Yea.
Alderman Beatty.
Yea.
Alderman Sistrunk.
Yea.
Vice Mayor Perkins.
Yea.
Alderman Vaughn.
Yea.
All right, it is unanimous. We are adjourned. Thank you, everyone. And for those going to MML,